of materials, if he wants everything.
Do you want a full set of everything?
You want a trade?
Okay.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the planning board meeting for Tuesday, November 17th. We start the meeting with the pledge of the flag.
I pledge allegiance to
the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We should put a camera in that corner so I can watch everybody and make sure they're actually doing it.
They get you standing up. Steve, we can move the flag into that corner and be all set.
We just went.
Have a roll call of members. Tom Young, Chair.
Mike Caprilio, Vice Chair.
Michael Croteau, Member.
Matt Shoemaker, Member.
I'm Steve Perry, Selectman Rep.
Absent is Jason Garrett and Russ Blanchett. Is there any public input tonight? Seeing none, we're going to the proposed zoning board changes. Jen?
Sir? You've got everything's there up on the site. You had two different documents. The first document covers the first 1, 2, 3, 4 items on your bulleted list: definitions, residential district setbacks, wetland overlay setbacks, and aquifer base maps. There's no changes to the aquifer base maps since that was last reviewed. So that one is just there because it's in the same document. So starting with definitions, since the last meeting, or based upon the discussion of the last meeting, retaining walls have been struck from the definition of structure, thus allowing them to be within the front setback. New definition is right-of-way. That was something that the board was discussing at the last meeting and was looking for a possible definition. So I'll pause there.
I can use electronic, I guess.
Okay, I can.
Kevin gets a Google site, right?
No.
Oh.
I probably should add them.
Sorry, copy.
Was the definition of right-of-way just pulled from somewhere else?
Pretty much.
Yeah, cut and paste, pretty standard. There's only some ways to discuss it.
To be honest, very few communities have a definition of right-of-way.
Yeah.
There was one that had something that was a little bit more rambly, and this seemed to make a little bit more sense. Just a little bit straightforward, but it just ties it back to the definition of roadways, highways, and statute as they're already defined. And then also pulling in, because the other piece though is if you just tie it to what you have as class 1 through class 5 highways, you got your paper streets that, you know, aren't necessarily going to fall in. You got your private streets that aren't necessarily going to fall into those classifications. But by pulling in anything that's been approved on a subdivision or a site plan, that clarifies. Then also, for example, you've got a new subdivision that's proposing a new roadway. You need something to capture that road that's proposed and not already in existence.
Close up in there.
Perfect. Both of those are good.
Okay. All right.
Just out of curiosity, in the definition of structure, it says framework. What, do you have any concept of what that might be referring to, Kevin?
This means, it actually means nothing.
Okay.
and really, it shouldn't even be in there. You can put
it's too late for that one.
Anything. You can put a temporary structure, or like a banner or something like that, or the van on the side of the road, but it's temporary.
Temporary is, yeah, that's different.
Framework never installed. Yeah. I don't understand why framework's there.
I guess I don't either. Key to the definition of structure, though, is that it's at a fixed location. So it's fixed implies permanent, not necessarily temporary construction. So you may have some temporary random framework of some sort, but
framework is, you can strike that out of there just as well and be all right. I never used it in all my years of being in construction.
I was just curious. I don't think it hurts anything being there.
Like tense permanent.
And it's like reviewing stands too. Yeah.
They come and go.
It's one of those things that if you leave it in there, there's no harm done, because chances are any sort of framework is going to be temporary and then not included in the definition anyways. But just in case you get something random and crazy.
And one time the definition of a structure was anything that was built.
Yeah,
that's was actually in the building code and also some zoning code can be used. Every mailbox is something that is built.
Yeah. That doesn't work.
A lot of this doesn't pertain to anything. It's just taken from somewhere.
All right, so then we have the changes to setbacks as well.
Correct. So the changes to setbacks is based on the proposal that Kevin brought to you last week. So the conversation pertained to, at least it's here, sheds, and allowing sheds to be within 10 feet of a side or rear lot line, and striking, yes, and creating that threshold for the size of the shed. And then for Albuquerque, striking the separate setback from Albuquerque. The one kind of thing I wanted just to kind of bring to the conversation or throw out there for you to think about when you're talking about the Albuquerque piece. There was a question of why on Albuquerque. Is it a larger setback than other roadways? You know, I don't know personally. I'm guessing it's the aesthetics, but there were some other just general conversations. So one thing to bear in mind is that the road cross section for Albuquerque and the right-of-way width is 75 feet versus a standard road, which is usually 50 feet for a right-of-way. So it is a wider road, so that there kind of plays with the geometry and the aesthetic as you're driving down that roadway. The other part of it is that it's got an offset center line, so its center line isn't at the center. The right-of-way on Albuquerque is such so that you have 25 feet on one side of the center line of the paved roadbed and 50 feet on the other side. And what that is allowing that additional width along that right-of-way for the bike path and network. That said, though, your property line still is back from there. So it's, you wouldn't have to worry about instances where the right-of-way, you'll have like older neighborhoods that don't necessarily have like a sidewalk where you'll have your road width, but the right-of-way is actually wider than your road width. And so folks will perceive that part of their front yard is their front yard, but it's not, it's part of the right-of-way. So it's not it's not that sort of configuration along Albuquerque.
That'd really be a headache for Kevin, though, right?
Why?
We don't really have to worry about that.
I don't know if somebody wants to do something.
A headache for you with applications as well.
Oh, true.
I don't know.
Oh, and the other thing is we were talking about the road speeds on Albuquerque. And yes, it is posted at 35, but it is designed for 45. So that's another part of that. And it's not necessarily, these aren't things, I'm not saying you should go one way or other with the setback. It just was more information that I found after the meeting. I just wanted to make sure you had.
I think we just keep it. I mean, with the new change, mm-hmm. with the 50.
The 50s?
Yeah.
So basically all that means is just striking out that sentence.
Yeah. Make it consistent. And now we have wetlands.
So wetlands has a bit more discussion. I have not made any amendments to the wetland district at this point. I did pull in the existing language as it stands today, but wanted to just throw that out for a little bit further consideration. And I understand that having like a, you know, a single number that we use for setbacks is easy, but a wetland setback versus a lot line setback, they're not the same thing. They shouldn't be treated the same. Lot line setbacks are for aesthetic reasons. They're for maintaining space between houses, creating, you know, minimizing density. You know, all, it goes back to the origins of zoning where they were looking to minimize sanitary issues, pervasive indoor plumbing, and so making sure there was adequate separation modern fire departments, making sure that there was adequate separation between homes for fires. I mean, those are the reasons why we have side setbacks, and for maintaining the kind of community character. Wetland setbacks are designed so that they maintain, that those wetlands can maintain their ecological functions. And there's a lot of literature out there as to what is an adequate setback. And generally science says if you have 100 feet, you're good, no matter what the quality of your wetland is. There's the New Hampshire method that evaluates the quality of a wetland and goes through this whole scoring mechanism. And then you can go from there, and dependent on the quality of the wetland, really depends on what the necessary buffer width is. But generally, it's anywhere from 50 feet to 100 feet. So you're still in that 50 to 100 for maintaining that ecological function.
And dependent on the functions of the wetland.
Correct. Correct. So before we move forward on this, I wanted to kind of put it out there. You have also a letter from the Conservation Commission that was posted to the site. And then I had posted some additional links to information on wetlands buffers. So wanted to throw it back out there for consideration before we moved ahead.
Well, hell, if we go by science, we might as well make it 200 feet. Then we're 100 feet away from the 100, and then we're really secure. Then we'll have no buildable land. That'll be great.
So just out of curiosity, what you were just saying about doing a study on a particular wetland just to figure out what the true like setback mm-hmm. should be, does that enable people, the way that it currently stands, can people get closer if they have a study done? Like, is there like an exception process or like a...
It can find a vernal pool and stay 200 feet away.
No, you've got what you have right now is a 50-foot no disturb buffer, and then a 75-foot no build buffer. So think of it this way, those first 50 feet, you want to keep undisturbed, because that undisturbed area and the vegetation within that undisturbed area is going to filter out any potential contaminants that are making it to that water body. But then, so you back up from that undisturbed area and you say, okay, now, assuming this is at the back of a lot, the wetlands at the back of the lot, you need space for a backyard, right? You're not going to put your house right up on the, you know, right on the edge of that, but that no disturb area. Then you can't mow your lawn. You can't put in a playground. So that's where you pull back another, that extra 25 feet to get the 75 feet so that you have room to lay out a lot so that you've got front yard, house, backyard, buffer, wetland, if you think of it in that cross section.
So when you brought that forth last week, though, you were saying...
I bring the real world and what I run across all my life on the buffers and what happens. I'll explain it when she's done, okay? I just bring in what I run across and the reason why I suggested it, based off the regulations, too, we have. The 75-foot buffer, now the way it reads, no structure. That includes everything. Okay, except for the exclusion in 12-06F. Construction, placement, or the maintenance of a permanent or temporary structure, included but not limited to sheds. Mm-hmm. What's temporary? Swimming pools can be placed in it, and propane tanks can be placed in it. Okay? Now, when you put a pool in, you're digging the ground, and you're putting concrete around it. See, the buffer is already, that extra 25 feet is not an issue. In the real construction sense of it, when a guy comes in and applies for a building permit, and he's going to try to put a house within exactly 50 feet off the buffer, it's never going to happen. Okay, it's never happened in my lifetime, because they got to have 10 to 15 feet of workspace around it. Okay, and that's basically what I make them do. That's what I have to do. Okay, they want to have a little lawn up to the grass area on the undisturbed. The buffers can be played with, and looking at the science of this is what I did as well. I did go to the Hampshire buffers, 1997 and 1998, I believe, is the year that was printed. It's in the library. There's a lot of debate on still the setbacks. Some say they're 50, some say they're 200. Some towns have 75s, but they allow certain things to be in it. It's not just no building. Our regulations say no structures. Well, I got into a point where I got sheds. Reality is what I'm dealing with, is reality. I'm not saying anything about the buffer. The buffer is what we should keep. I'm not debating that at all. I think the buffer is an important part. Based off the type of wetlands, now I'm going to say the type of wetlands. One thing our wetland regulation doesn't really address very well is wetlands and how good it is and how bad it is and why it's there. We pick a number of 2,000 square feet to be, we don't have to worry about it. You don't have to have the setback if it's only 2,000 square feet. But we got such a waiver of the contours where you may have a pocket this size, less than 2,000 square feet, which is what this is, okay? And it comes to a channel about 5 feet because of the topo, and it goes out 100 feet. Then it just ends up being a 75-foot buffer, but it doesn't really apply. It's not a good wetlands, unless there's a vernal pool in it, and that's another issue all by itself. So we don't really delineate a wetlands. I'm not here to destroy the wetlands. I think the 75 foot, in my opinion, is intrusive. People here have bought homes with a 50 foot buffer. It's on their deeds. All of a sudden, we overlay it with a 75. Half the buildings are in it. I got to send them to the zoning board to do something. It's meaningless sometimes, okay? Because there's nothing on the science as to the type of wetlands. Now, maybe if the town had a wetlands delineation map with good and, you know, there are, our wetland, the regulation is a blanket one, just wetlands. And it does get into a lot of the soil types, the vegetation and stuff like that, okay? You know, the definitions of certain wetlands. It was done during a time where wetland delineation was more aggressive. That had changed. Okay, we changed ours too, because there was a time where you couldn't build because of some soil type or little vegetation. You couldn't do anything. The state brought that back. The federal government brought that back. Now it's gone now. Okay, they pulled back on it because it was too aggressive all over the country. So what I'm trying to say, I think the 75 foot is the number that you can pick. We're allowed to put sheds and pools in it, the way this reads, but I can put a pool in the ground and have a concrete apron all the way around up to the buffer. Okay, what I'm saying, stick with the 50 foot. I got to deal with the house disturbing that in the first place. It's going to be flagged off, or I'm going to have the plot plan to show that it can't be done. And I'm a pickler on that. Okay, I have walked. My background is soils. Okay, so I know how to tell it. I've got a little wildland or not. So everything that I do, and when a homeowner comes in, I'll walk the lot based off the information I got. And I'll go out there and see if it's actually correct. Okay, and there's been many cases where it's been, when surveyors and large scopes go in and do something, they put a bunch of little flags, and the guy goes out there and just locates it. Well, they just get a line. That's not what really is in the field exactly. So I deal with each home, and I try to get it to match and still get what they need or want. Some cases they can't get it, we got to relocate. But it's an on-site situation with the building part of it, okay, that I have to do. So to me, the 7 to 75 does not pertain, because I'm still going to have 10 feet minimum of grass area or undisturbed. Okay, there's nothing that prevents me to put a driveway in the buffer. Okay, the 75 foot. Okay, I can have that and come into the garage. So I'm just trying to work it out. Okay, so that's why I was thinking it's wise to stick to some consistency with the setback.
When was it 50? How long ago?
50.
Some homes have 50.
Yeah.
They're deeded as 50.
50, this was prior to 2001. It was all up to 50.
So that was the lowest it ever was?
Correct.
Okay.
There was a case where it was 25, and it still is here, by the way. And that is each case, each scenario is different. And that's when you get into existing drainage ditches, swales that were done for conservation or agriculture reasons or road reasons. Those does not apply to them. The 75 feet. And a lot of people doesn't know, I know where they are. I was born and raised here. Okay, I remember seeing them being ditches. Today they got trees growing through them because no one maintains the ditches anymore. But it's still a ditch. And someday it's going to be maintained because it's holding back the water. It's causing the problem.
You said workspace. What do you mean workspace? Do you mean the when you build a home, you can't go over the 50 with a 10 foot around the foundation for the digging of the home?
The house would be approximately 60 feet away. Okay, it'll be 10 feet away from the 50-foot buffer line.
Okay, so you're 10 feet from the buffer to
right,
the foundation.
Correct, the foundation, because when you dig the hole, you start doing the excavation, and you got to deal with the sloping or grading issue. If I can't get the grades to work, we don't go into the buffer. I'd look at a retaining situation, which I've done in the past.
How about, I don't know if we do this, but 75% for the residents and 50 feet when if you do the sheds, the pools, the other items.
They're still allowed.
No, but you said you can't do that within the 75.
Oh, I can.
So
you can.
So yeah. Sheds, pools, anything else besides the home could be in the 75 foot.
Yep. Mm-hmm. And that's the part that gets me, because pools can be tricky. And then a good in-ground pool, a nice one, gunite. I got a beautiful one up on Heron Drive. The woman did a great job on that with the ledge and everything else there. Gorgeous. But it's about the buffer too.
Yep.
She's in it. Okay. So I was just meant, I'm thinking of this as, in my real world approach to it, to pick the number. Yes, so 75. According to the buffer stuff, sorry for my iPad for being, but I went through, I read this all the other night. My wife asked me why. Okay, I answered her, I don't know. But it did get into a lot of the history, where it came from, what towns have. it depends in what this test says. Right from the beginning, it's the type of wetlands you're trying to protect. Okay, that's the key point. Okay, if there's a wetland that's more important with something else, and the same applies with the vernal pool on the setbacks, so they get into the migration of the salamanders, don't go this way, they actually go this way. But the 200 foot is just a number they picked here. But the migration of the little buddies go the other way. And there's changes on that too. Some groups go the other way. Some don't leave. It all depends which salamander you're gonna get.
So with respect to the types of wetland though, we were just talking about studies to determine what's what. Right. I would imagine those are fairly expensive.
The Conservation Commission back in, I believe it was 97, did do the New Hampshire method on mm-hmm. a lot of the wetlands. We didn't designate any prime wetlands. Mm-hmm. We did go through function values of quite a few wetlands. I would like to, can I speak to some of Kevin's comments?
Sure.
The way we delineate wetlands, a wetland scientist goes out, we use the three-tier parameter now, the Army Corps method, mm-hmm. which is they use soils, vegetation, and hydrology. Mm-hmm. Has to hold water for a certain amount of time.
Mm-hmm.
So that's, years ago, we could have three lines in the field. When we had a town line, a state line, a federal line. Now we use the Army Corps method. So that's pretty clear. And we only use certified soil scientists. We don't go out and survey wetlands. 2,000 square feet is still a valuable wetland under that, like he says, for migration of animals, but we weren't going to be so restrictive, so we went with the 2,000 square feet.
Right. So just as a point of clarification, that means that if a wetland is less than 2,000 square feet, it doesn't fall under this regulation.
That's what I said.
Kevin was saying, though, that means it's completely, there's no extension beyond its boundary. So there could be
a finger.
6-inch. Stream of that wetland that goes out to a much larger body that's much further back, but that would all be contiguous. Still.
It's
so
contiguous,
that's,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. We picked 50 feet. The buffer book, which was written in 97, there has been a lot of data since then, is scientifically written by, was OSP at the time, now it's OEP, Office of Energy and Planning. It was Office of State Planning then with Audubon Society, and a Natural Resources Conservation District did a lot of work on buffers and trying to come up with a number. The state actually right now is looking at a statewide buffer. They don't have one, but they're looking at that right now.
Is there any indication as to what they're thinking they might want to see for that?
It's still in work committee right now.
One of the links that I provided you with is to a legislative study commission from 2008. I think the report was released in 2010. And one of the commission's subcommittees specifically was looking at wetland buffers and looking at a proposal for a statewide buffer system. So that their proposal is in there. It was a preliminary proposal. It didn't go anywhere at the time because the New Hampshire method was in the process of being revised. The updated version was not yet complete, so it hadn't been tested and it wasn't certain what the new version of the methodology would capture. So it was uncertain what the impacts would be.
Right, the New Hampshire method has recently been revised and it's more geared to the professionals and having a professional study done rather than by volunteers. The first one was mostly exclusively done by volunteers. I don't think 50 with a 70-foot building setback is that restrictive to homeowners. I think the town is probably, Jen, correct me on this, about 75% built out anyway.
Probably.
So,
right.
Maybe it's a moot point, I don't know.
Any idea how much a wetland survey costs? Like, is that something that a homeowner could, if the homeowner was interested in,
Well, if they're coming in for an application, they have to do one.
They have to do a wetland delineation.
They have
typically thousands.
That's one of the conditions in this book.
Very likely.
that under the wetland delineation, the Conservation Commission can allow them to do, had wants that in their hands.
That's if they had a, if they want to do an add-on and they were pre.
So you got to go, so what happens here, if you do get in this the way it is now, you would have to go to the Conservation Commission, spend the money to get a wetland study done, get their blessings, maybe, and still go to the zoning board.
No, you would have to have a certified soil scientist, but that's not for every lot. That's for those pre-yearless lots.
So let me ask this. In the interest of trying to move this forward, the 75-foot setback's only for houses. Everything else that you're going to do with your land is pretty much what is allowable at 50 feet.
Okay, what happens if I want to put a deck on it?
All right. Is it that important to us to change the setback by 25 feet? We've already spent over 20 minutes on this, and we haven't gotten anywhere.
Oh, you've heard.
Well, you've gotten some education, I hope.
All I will say is that the Conservation Commission reviewed this when it came before them the other night.
I have it.
We have a letter here, and it was recommended to keep it at 75.
That's it.
And they felt that that was reasonable, considering what the scientific data that's available out there. So,
Kevin, with respect to you're bringing this up as something that you're running into with this, with the point that John just made about us being, you know, largely built out in town. Where do you still see that as a problem? I mean, is this a problem for existing structures? You say decks is one example of that. But the big example was with
additions and stuff like that to existings that are 50 foot on their plan now, and they're going to be in the existing houses in the 75 foot.
But don't they get grandfathered for that?
Existing one, but if I want to add on and expand into that, I got to go to the conservation, then to the planning, then to the zoning board.
Why is the conservation people even hear it? Because if it doesn't go to the zoning board, like they don't have
they have no regulatory action.
Yeah, conservation board is just an advisory. It's
and that's
they have no ability to bless
and they'd
or
be
deny.
At the zoning anyway.
Yeah, they're going to be fighting it one way or the other. Okay. Or saying yes or no, or yes, whatever. But the bottom line, it says here, special exception, and it says it's got to go to the conservation district 25 days prior to.
Prior to what? What was the year?
The hearing. Okay. And it's got to come to me for health officer, because that's health officer, I got to review it. Because it's getting the septics and stuff like that, but this is not, 99% you won't get those. You won't even get that. Unless it's a septic tank that you got no choice in. The state laws supersede a lot of that when we get in the south. But I'm just saying, okay, that's how it has to go through. Now, it's more red tape. That's how I look at it as. Okay, I'll be honest with you. Okay? I'm looking at, remember, 2001, this went into place. 50% of the homes in this town were built prior to that. And those people are within 25 feet or 75 feet or 50 feet of the wetlands. So you're talking 50% of the population of homes or more, okay, will be involved with regulatory function. For what reason? Scientific reason. If each case, you know, we look at it in a sense, there's a building setback. As long as we can maintain the 50-foot buffer, that's the key. I think most of I got here are 50 feet. Because it was done back in the 80s. The 70s we're never going to get over. A lot of us can't get over a goal in that comment. Okay? But I'm just saying, okay? You got the 80s and the 90s. A lot went on. 2000, we've had a few, but not the, and many, and most of those all meet the 75-foot. But I can put a pool in there and get rid of the common sense of it, you know? I can't put a addition onto my house, but I can put an in-ground pool with an apron around it.
Do you know what the logic is behind that?
Gives the frogs a place to swim.
Realistically, I mean, well, you said, the one thing that you said it was...
I'm looking at, the purpose of the 75-foot setback is not disturb the 50-foot setback. That's the purpose of it. That's it. Okay?
Because then you have the 75, and then you have room to put in a pool or whatever you want to put in that. If you have the 50-foot, where are you going to put your pool or your...
Well, but I think Kevin's point is... If you choose to forego that, you know, you can't put the pool in, that's, you know, that you're making that decision, you know, full well knowing that you are not going to be able to...
The buffer cannot be disturbed. The 50-foot, I'm not touching. I'm not talking about that. I'm not talking about that. I'm just talking about the 75-foot.
Right,
right.
Okay? So I can do anything else in that 25 feet, so put an addition onto the house. Or a deck.
So, part of the basis for wetland buffering, it depends on what you're trying to
the
protect.
Buffer.
So, for habitat, it's generally recognized that 100 feet is reasonable. For if that wetland is high habitat quality wetland, then 100 feet. But if a wetland is of high water quality or quantity functions, in other words, it's providing aquifer recharge and making sure you have good, safe drinking water, then you only need 50 feet because phosphorus, which is one of the biggest issues, can be filtered out within that 50 feet vegetated buffer before it gets to that wetland and before you have water quality contamination as a result. So think of it this way, by having that 75 feet, you've got a compromise. You've definitely preserved that 50 foot that you need to protect your water quality and quantity. You're also adding a little bit more room so that you're making a compromise on the habitat side. So you're allowing a little bit more space. You know, your moose, your frogs, your turtles can wander through your backyard. They can't wander through your house. And so that's part of that rationale.
If a pool is no different than an addition, because it is the cement in the ground, the same issue, why not keep a 75 foot for the residents and expand the, like an addition or a deck as being allowed within that 25 feet from the 75 to the 50? Like you would have a pool, why not expand that to say you could have a living room built or a deck or, but I understand the core house, the base of the house has to be within the 75, but be a little less restrictive from the 75 to the 50.
Yeah, but then, I mean, you're going to get people that may just say, okay, I'll put the whole back of my house I'm going to blow out and just add on to it. I mean, it's one of those things, I think, if you're going to let them build in there, you just got to let them build in there. And if you're not going to let them build in there, you got to say, no, you can't.
Right now, you can let them do anything you want in there. And they can make a garden in that 20-foot.
Well, no, you can't, because if it's attached to that, if it's a deck.
You're talking about the 25-foot buffer, the 25-foot stretch.
If it's attached to the house, though.
Right, I can't do anything. I can put it... I've had cases now with open decks projecting into an over, okay, which makes sense because it's not closed. Anybody can walk, get out of the rain. But
when you talk about habitats, the wetlands are already surveyed, right? So I'm not very familiar with wetland classifications. Are they classified based on, you know, this is a habitat area versus this is just a, you know, aquifer recharge versus, I mean, is it something that we could delineate?
There's 9 functional values to a wetland. So when they go out and study them, they can choose what functional values they have, you know, water recharge, habitat, all kinds of things.
So they're currently classified based on those.
But they may not, each one may not be classified. I mean, we didn't do New Hampshire method on the whole town. So if somebody was coming in with a big development or even a subdivision of some kind, then they would delineate the wetlands, and we would probably go out and look at it and see, you know, are they more specific, what type of wetlands they are, and then call in a soil scientist or more specialized person to say, yes, this is a habitat. We did that on Cutler Road to verify that it was a vernal pool. But just the regular person's not going to know what they've got out there for a wetland. Unless, you know, they have some clue of what's using it. And
I would assume that the wetland scientist who went out there does it would have the same thing you're talking about, though. To bring in another outsider with an opinion.
Right.
Everybody will have, everyone has them, Joan, you know, okay? You know, which
pool. Right, I'm just trying to figure out if it's something where we could say, you know, like, I recognize the value of giving a good buffer for habitat. Like, that makes sense to me. So I guess I'm just trying to say, is there a way to be able to look at it and say, we don't necessarily need that here. Like, is there a way to delineate, you know, so that that way, if there isn't really that need for that extra 25-foot protection for the habitat component mm-hmm. of it, can we allow building within that?
That would require restructuring your ordinance and creating a tiered system that would require an analysis under the New Hampshire method to determine what functional values are provided by that wetland. And then tiering your setbacks to correspond to what wetland functions are of high quality that you're trying to protect.
You might as well tell any developers, don't ever even try to build here.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
the cost to do it would be ridiculous.
No. Yeah.
It'd just be way out of line on that one.
No. Individual homeowners aren't going to do it.
No.
Yeah.
Which is why doing the 75-foot is a compromise.
Well, I threw it out. I still think it's a good thing to cut it back to the 50, because really, we say one thing and we're allowing something else. And that's how I see it, okay? I really think it's wise that we, I have no problem, we allow projections of a house to go over into the 75 foot.
Okay? How often does the zoning board deny?
Zoning board hasn't had any. I do not send anything to the zoning board.
So how many times have residents been rejected? I guess is maybe the better way to put it.
It's going to happen soon. I've rejected additions because of it.
Well, how many?
Me? At least five or six in the last year. Okay. I try not to go to the board. I try to work in.
No, I'm just curious how.
And they really don't want to go to the boards because of the function that has to get to the board. Okay. It's not just going to the board. I want to put in additions. Like going to the conservation. Why do you want to do it? You got to come. You got to hire somebody to be a scientist and answer the question. Well, why do I want to do that to put an addition on? Okay. What else can I do? So it discourages them to even think about it, because.
In all fairness to the Conservation Commission, I mean, we are a board that recommends and advises, we don't regulate. So if, you know, we make a recommendation, it's not, you know, necessarily going to be something that either unless the zoning board or whoever the authority is going to make that decision.
That's correct.
So.
And at the next conservation meeting, I'll bring up that, you know, we should revisit the ordinance and look at that specific section that says, there's a date in there that says prior to that to date you have to go to the Conservation Commission. We'll take a look at that.
And the I think the New Hampshire is it the New Hampshire Fish and Game Department has the New Hampshire Wildlife Action Plan.
Right. Yes.
And I know that they have GIS maps that identify habitat. I don't know in terms of wetlands.
Mm. In terms of wetlands,
it goes specific.
No, on a site specific level, the data mapping is not there. It's really good for more general, broader areas. On a parcel by parcel basis, the margin of error can be off by, depending on the data layer, hundreds of feet, tens of feet, hundreds of feet, to in some, 1,000 feet. So,
Joan, when you approach that, could you also just get some idea what the rationale for allowing something like a pool or a driveway in those zones would be? Just because, again, it would be good to understand.
Mm-hmm.
You know what the difference is. I mean, to me, a driveway, particularly if someone's salting it, is like
it's worse. Yeah.
It's worse
than a house. Yeah, worse than an addition. So
wait a minute. It's probably an oversight. Probably should be 75 for everything. That was probably.
So
the
you're
intent.
Saying I'm raining on the parade now?
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, I'm going to say that.
I mean, I'm doing it in the interest of maybe seeing if Kevin has a legitimate.
No, I mean. As I said,
I have a legitimate reason. I'm trying to be consistent.
Reason, but I mean,
and I'm looking at the science of this whole thing. I'm looking at what you're allowing. I look what we can do. And the 75-foot does not make sense, in my opinion. Okay? And that's my opinion. So I just wanted to bring it to you guys as an option to look at this year to see if you want to put it on the ballot. Okay? and go from there. If I win or lose, you know, what the hell? It's a crapshoot in this game we play.
It's not a win or lose. We're all supposed to be working together.
I'm just saying about that section. I got another one I want to talk to you about. Lawyers, I'm not.
Are you kidding me?
Well, I mean, the Conservation Commission does do its due diligence.
I'm not arguing.
Read your website before you get here.
I did.
Good.
Calendar-wise, we're running out of time.
Do I heard some put in the ballot? I mean,
I don't think it's.
Put in the ballot. See what happens.
That are not included in the.
I think they're good questions.
They're good questions.
Why can't you just make it an advisory element on the ballot? Does it take a temperature of what people in town want?
Because
mm-hmm.
people
advisory.
In town don't even know why they shouldn't be raking their leaves into a wetland. That's why.
That's not the point, though. There's some people
there
we
residents.
Know that don't go to town meeting and they have a lot to say.
And they
I mean, this is something that needs to be done based off of
grass
actual.
That's and that's what I'm basing my logic
right.
off of what I see out there.
It's
okay, and what I've done. Okay, and what is being done? Be practical. It's what's being done. You take that 75-foot buffer. They're going to put a shed out there. How big's the shed?
Well, that's why I'm asking for more information on what, you know, what the rationale is.
I can't prevent a barn from being built there. Cannot stop that legally.
So
building?
I would say, so here's the practical.
Big shed.
The practical reality. Your next meeting, the first meeting in December, is your last opportunity to look at a draft and vote to send it to hearing. Joan actually technically needs to notice that hearing that same day before you show up. So to submit it to the newspaper, it doesn't actually go in the newspaper until after you've made that vote. So if it's not ironed out here this evening, at least kind of we're definitive, we're going this direction, it's good, we're okay to send it to hearing, we're out of time to meet the town meeting calendar cycle is the bigger issue. So where there's a lot of questions, I think it's something that, you know, put it on the to-do list and collaborate with the Conservation Commission, answer some of your questions, do a little bit more research and come up with a thoughtful proposal if there is to be a change.
Agreed.
Well, I like to say that I disagree, but I have a right to say that. Mm-hmm. Okay, I disagree. I just think the logic's already there. What's being happened here is that Jen is saying no because she doesn't feel it's a good idea, and I agree with her in some parts of that, but not all of it. I think the 75 foot is not necessary. Okay, I think the town has to take the step to look at what they got for wetlands. Instead of just blanketing a number. That's my point. What are you protecting out there? Why?
Well, I think the discussion has
saying,
to be
okay.
with the CONCOM.
Okay, I'm all set
for
with that
record,
one. Make a decision.
My only concern is that we don't have a concrete proposal of what exactly would get changed. Therefore, I do not think it's appropriate to change at this time.
We need more information before we change the calendar.
You're going to get a permit from me now.
Hey, in the interest of moving forward,
record,
Mr. Chairman,
you.
can I say a question going backwards?
Yep.
That's awesome.
I could go backwards.
In the setbacks, we are striking the statement for Albuquerque Avenue, all buildings and structures shall be set back a minimum of 75 feet from the edge of right-of-way. I believe if you look back, we had that statement in there when it was 50 feet, and it was just changed to 75. So by striking that, you'll now get a shed 10 feet.
No.
Yes, you will.
No, because there's an exception for the...
It's not a sideline.
It's from a rear or side. Not.
And it's also, it's 50 feet from the front lot line and public rights away. So if your side lot line is along Albuquerque, it's still along a public right of way, and it still require 50 feet.
Okay. Just wanted to check.
But that makes a good point. Oh, actually, no. I still said for the shed exclusion, it says, but must still be a minimum of 50 feet from the front lot line and public rights away.
Correct.
So sheds also still have the 50 foot from
yep.
Albuquerque.
That's correct, Steve. That's a 50-foot deal.
Yeah.
Sounds good.
Okay.
Moving forward.
What if they set their wetlands?
Huh?
Don't go there. That was a good one. you wanted to bring up. You're just going somewhere. You're going to get me in trouble.
Okay.
And the board consensus on the wetland?
What if for next year?
District.
We got to hold off on it.
Yeah, I think we should look into this a little bit more. Maybe, you know, have a discussion with the Conservation Commission or something to try to, even zoning, to see what we can do.
I agree.
Suggestion that we set up a meeting after the first of the year, the three boards get together?
Yeah, that's a good idea, if they're willing to do that.
Sure.
And the Aquifer Protection District, that didn't change, correct, Jen?
Correct.
Okay. What else do we have?
Zoning.
I didn't think that we would spend as much time on some of these other things. That's okay. So I just wanted to, we briefly touched on the frontage piece at the last meeting. And there was also conversation about moving towards a table of dimensional use model. So I wanted to just kind of pull the two back together and take a few minutes to look at what it looks like. So here's my one concern with the residential district language as it stands. I think we, at the last meeting, folks said, you know, we're okay with leaving it as it is, but maybe not. It wasn't 100%. Because there would be some parcels out there that wouldn't have a minimum frontage requirement. You could have lots being created that are unbuildable lots. These are kind of lots left in limbo. And you have no minimum. So somebody comes in, what is the standard to which you're going to hold them to? An applicant has the right to know what the expectation is. And so the way the frontage provision is currently drafted, you have no minimum for undeveloped lots. So what should they expect? They want to make sure, applicants want to know that when they come into you, they have an understanding of where they stand in the universe. That you're not going to arbitrarily say, it was okay over there, but no, for you here, no, it's got to be something different. So that's why we have minimums in statute. So if the minimum for an undeveloped lot is different than a single family residential, define it. If the sample that I have here just says no, everything's 150 feet in the residential district. If it's a duplex, it's 200 feet. And I've given you two different ways of structuring this. The first is you just change that one provision, 502.02, just change frontage and say no, all lots require 150 feet unless you're proposing a duplex, and then it's 200. The other option is moving towards that table dimensional use model, which I started to lay out. I only did a quick version of it because I didn't want to invest the time if you were not interested in going this route. So I've only laid out how residential would look like. So how that would work in that alternate framework would be section 300 of your zoning ordinance that's just districts. Here are the districts in the town. You would just right within that section say, here are the districts and here are the minimum lot requirements for those districts. And then it'd be right there. It'd list out in a table for all of your districts what your frontage, your setbacks, and your minimum lot area is. Then you would use, so you have the reason you have paragraphs, I know at the last meeting you were like, why do we have paragraphs, why don't we have bullets? The reason you have paragraphs is because you have a lot of exceptions that are created that says, well, it's this unless you're over here, and then it's that. And so what happens there is you'd use just little footnotes under the table that says, okay, for in this example, I've already got four of them and only did residential district. First note is, hey, this is just your base districts. Your overlay districts, you still need to go check those because you have other standards that are in the overlay districts. Go to those sections of the zoning ordinance if they apply. Your second is just on area, you know, because in a table, you don't want to add in all this extra verbiage that says minimum contiguous lot size. That should actually be minimum contiguous dry.
Mm-hmm.
So that just goes into a footnote rather than putting all that verbiage in the title or in the column header. And then you've got within your residential district, you've got separate standards for frontage and lot size for duplexes. And then you have your sheds provision also that's another kind of exclusion. So that's just kind of laying out how it would look like. And then what follows is I then went to section 500, which is the residential district, and showed those sections that could then be struck from the ordinance because you've now got this table at the front end that replaces those paragraphs. So that's all I had, and then throwing it.
With respect to the undeveloped land with the table model, you're saying it doesn't matter because it's either zone, it's zone residential.
It's all lots. Yeah.
I like the table better, personally. I think that it's going to be a lot cleaner. I think it's going to make it a lot easier to find the information and to interpret the information. And it also closes any loopholes.
What loopholes?
It's more likely to make new ones.
Oh, it's going to make one already. I can see it reading now.
What's that?
I'm going to go back to the same thing I said before. There was nothing wrong with the residential the district the way it was written. Our lawyers figured because of the way the question was asked. Zoning-wise, our zoning is fine. On a subdivision, you need 150 feet of frontage. You need an acre plus land based on wetlands, whatever you got there. That's it. Only time you guys are going to see somebody come in here in the residential district, because if you look at the uses that are allowed in the residential district, you're not getting anything else that would require you to have them. Okay, the uses alone allowed in the residential district state simply, okay, where am I? Uses permitted, single family home, two families. Farming is related all through, you're allowed to farm. Mm-hmm. Litchfield wants that. Planning board, I know, wants that. The taxpayers want it. Mm-hmm. Okay, utility structures up to 200 square feet. That was put in at the time when Lamar Bell was going to put in these little huts here and there, or whatever it was. That was a common practice back in that time period. Okay, home occupations would have nothing to do with subdivision, just allowable use in a house that's there now. Sand and gravel extraction, that's the RSA. If you got a right-of-way, you can go in and extract it. You just got to follow the RSA and our gravel regulations. Manufactured housing parks in residential districts, subject to divisions of another whole section. That's allowed.
But that under this, the way frontage is currently structured, manufactured housing in a park, what frontage would you apply to it?
Well, that's another question that I have on that, but I don't think it's for 150 feet because it wouldn't make the density issue that we're talking about. Well, that's another area. Independent open space for housing development for the older people. Well, that's been struck completely. The only area it's mentioned in here is on this section right now. Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's gone. So really, what is written here now in our residential zoning regarding the frontage, it's fine. There's nothing that prevents what happened last week to do something, to subdivide a lot and make it a non-buildable lot. Why not? It's exactly the way the guy's going in there with the knowing that he can't build on it. And what's wrong with that? Okay?
Yeah, but that, I mean, it sounded to me like the whole premise is to approach that later, though, right? Is to approach what they want to do with that later.
Right, and that's the premise.
They're subdividing it for a reason. They're not just subdividing it. Just
they're subdividing it now to get the 2 acres of the main lot to that person. Okay. What happens in the future? What difference does it make? As long as it meets the zoning requirements, and that's what they have to go and they go next.
The difference that makes is what we discussed last week, which is, do we end up with a bunch of these unbuildable lots that are just kind of in limbo?
You won't.
Well, what happens when they do that? Like, what happens with that lot?
I never see. If they have to go in there, they're going to go to the zoning board for one lot. Or they build a road. That's what we need now. In this town, there's more roads to take care of. We're not going to want that. Okay? It's off a state road. I'm just being logical here. Maybe I'm a little old-fashioned, I guess, okay? But the history is not repeating itself. It's consistent. This is the first time Jen has had it in this town. Mm-hmm. It's the first time that I've had it. I'm in my lifetime, okay? Because 99% of the people that come before the town, that want to go before the town or want to do something, don't want to come to the planning board in the first place, but it is something that has to be done. And they don't want to come back again, so they try to get as much as they can. This guy elected not to. That he had the right to do that. So what the attorney is saying to us, because she feels it's wrong, and I disagree with her, okay, I'll be the first to admit it, since I didn't have privy to talk to her, so I have to ask her to read it again. And she never got back to me. Okay? But to say that, you know, our zoning, there's nothing wrong with the way it's written if you read the whole thing. The way it's written, what else can you do out there? I'm going to bring up a point that just happened just recently, about two years ago here. There's a barn built on Route 3A down the road here near the Blacklands, we call it. Rick Charbonneau built the barn on his own lot. That lot did not have access or right-of-way on the Route 3A. It's a barn. Legally, I could do it because he owns everything around it. He has access to it off his driveway to get to it because the variance goes through the whole thing. So that's why he's got a barn. It's not a house, guys. It's legal. Okay? And it meets the intent of what we try to do with our zoning regulations. There's one sector right there. Okay? As long as it's not a house, we shouldn't be worried about it. Okay? Unless it's going to affect certain things. And this regulation, your lot line, your uses alone, in a residential zone in Litchfield has been always trying to be an agricultural point, okay, in their Route 3A sector, I'll say. They're quite clear.
So I just don't think we're going to have a bunch of people coming into town.
You won't get them.
Hey, I'm looking to start a farm. Can I use some of your unbuildable lots? You know what I mean? Like, I don't think
I got it going on now.
Never know.
You're never going to know.
There's a lot of people. Farming is the next wave. You know, I mean,
maybe. It may be a survival point. Who knows the way this world's turning right now?
I mean, the way it stands right now is we have people that continue to do that. We put conditions of approval on the plans that basically are saying to them, good luck trying to get a variance on this because you're...
Why are you putting that condition on it?
Because the attorney said to.
The attorney recommended it. Remember, it's a recommendation.
She's doing that.
For what reason?
To prevent people from trying to backdoor the system.
They're not backdooring the system.
If you approve that lot and without that condition of approval, now you have people that can say, you let me split this lot up, mm-hmm. and now I want to build on it, and it's useless to me. There's no value in this land to me anymore. That's a hardship. Now you have to grant me a variance.
Right. She's protecting the town from court cases.
And so now all of a sudden our zoning is completely bypassed because people are like, oh, I can build on whatever I want as long as I make it a non-buildable lot first.
I can give you another lawyer to tell you something altogether different.
But that's the one we're paying to defend us.
That's what we had before we lost. Guys, I'm just bringing up what I know what the reality is. The fear is what you're afraid of. Fine. Okay? Not an issue with me. I just wanted to say my two cents in it and go from there. I know what I'm going to recommend when people ask me to vote. It's going to be different. I'll be honest with you, okay? There's nothing wrong with that. There you go. Thanks.
All right.
I'm not upset. I'm just telling you how I feel.
Yeah, I appreciate that. I'm just having a lively debate with each other.
I've been chasing with planning board with different boards with different things. Next year, this will all change.
What's the pleasure of the good?
Don't look at me.
You're part of both of you.
I said it last week, I'll say it again. I don't see any reason to redevelop the wheel. What we had was fine. We made it work. It wasn't an issue. If the lawyer says we should change it, okay. But you also don't have to make a decision in the next in a week or two, you know what I mean?
So
you can stew on it for a little while and maybe do it next year. You don't have to rush into something for the fact of feeling you got to put something on the ballot. That's the only thing I feel. And it always happens. It comes December and there's the scramble because the feel is that there always has to be something there.
If we don't put it on this year, they won't let us next year.
So I don't see a lot of demand of people coming in to make non-buildable lots. I mean, that's kind of backwards to me.
Right.
Yeah, it is. I would agree with that point, and I would also agree that, you know, if we do table it, it's something that we can see if it happens again. I mean, you know, the precedent right now is that we're going to put a condition of approval on it anyways. That's mm-hmm. going
to... I've never had one come until this time.
Yeah.
No, I'll be honest with you. I've been doing this for a long time.
Yeah.
And I'll be honest with you. This table idea.
So nice and neat.
I kind of like it, but I'd like to see more of it.
Yeah, I only did a first pass because it was wasn't gonna invest the time.
No, and I get that.
To move on something that
my initial, but again, my default is I'm going back to why reinvent the wheel.
Right.
But it is nice if it's all in one spot. So it's kind of...
You're just making it easier for people to comprehend and understand. Why wouldn't you?
So in essence, we're all on the same page.
Jen, could you complete this one that you did? Just so we see what the whole thing looks like for all the districts?
Could you also maybe pull another town that has this already working?
There's a lot of towns actually go with this model.
And just dump it in so we can open it and go through it and kind of see how they structure the whole thing.
Yeah, there's...
Is that possible?
Yeah, I'll email you. I'm trying to think right off the top of my head. Like, I know Manchester does, but please, for the love of God, don't go look at Manchester's.
Well, yeah, no.
So many districts that it's out of control. It's not a good example.
I want something more compatible
to us. Yes, I know. And there was one that I was specifically looking at the other day.
Do you know Hollis has one?
Hollis has got their ordinances and provisions are very similar to yours. So no. So to that end, there are several communities that have the exact identical language, and particularly this residential district frontage 150 feet for single family and 200 feet for two family. And I will tell you. The way that their ordinances are administered is you have 150 feet of frontage for all lots because it's got to be developable. You can only approve something that's a conforming lot. Therefore, you have to have some form or shape of frontage that comes from a number in the ordinance. So they apply the 150 unless it's the two family. And then it's not necessarily something that you would normally see. It'd be something that code enforcement would see when they pull a permit. And then they check and see if there was 200 feet. So just in terms of how the ordinance is administered, that's how things are out there in your neighboring peers. So that's, you know, creating some inconsistency there, which is fine, because you are not the other communities. But I'm trying to think. All right, I'll email you guys a link to a community that does have that. It's
perfect.
Not coming off the top of my head right now.
Most towns, too, they don't use the chart that I know of. They use the line, residential, this one, 150 feet, area, this side. Instead of using the chart, this is a zoning district. Commercial. Very cut and dry.
Similar to a child. But not as aesthetically pleasing.
I just want to make sure. I'm not here to aggravate the system. I'm just telling you what the system is. As a zoning administrator, which is my duty, is to interpret this wonderful document. I interpret as written, okay? And that's what I do. That's what the law is clear to me. It tells me I have to do this, and I do it.
But the chart is just everything that's in the paragraphs, but easier to look at. So what's the difference?
Yes.
You're not changing.
Residential.
We close the loophole by virtue of the fact that this chart is saying it's now residential.
It's all lots. It does not.
Happens.
Yeah. The chart just says all lots for each district. It does not judge a lot based upon use unless you create a specific exception down, with one of those number notes.
It looks good.
Let's continue to work on that.
Yeah.
I think that if we could see some more.
I think Steve, you're right. Let's not rush into it. Let's get it right.
Yeah. Do you have anything else, Jen?
No, I do not.
Okay. Everybody had a chance to look at the meetings, minutes for the November 3rd meeting?
I make a motion to accept the minutes of the November 3rd meeting as written.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? All abstained?
Abstained.
Motion passes 4-0-1. Does anybody have any reports? Not appearing. Anybody have anything else to bring up before the meeting?
Yes, I do. We did get a letter on November 9th from Pine Creek Association stating they are requesting an affirmed date for the needed completion to site plan, the placement of the final 1-inch wearing course, and any other problems stipulated by the LC Engineering letter of June 10th, 2015. Communication between Ashwood Development, Kevin Lynch, the town inspector, and Pine Creek Board of Directors has been unsuccessful in scheduling these projects by the end of 2015. Ashwood Development Companies continues to push back these projects, and the Board of Directors of Pine Creek want to be assured that the scope of work will be completed according to LC Engineering Company report by early spring. So, would you like them to come in the next meeting, or what would you like to do?
Mike, would you do me a favor and take this? I would recuse myself because I live there.
Right. Tom steps down.
Sure. I think bring it to the next meeting to discuss. I mean, has there not been any response at all? When was the last conversation? Or I don't know if that's
Kevin, going do you want to speak to this?
I'll speak to this a little bit. Ashford Homes has been tardy, is the word I'm going to use. We have a bond for the completion of the road, in other words, the finished paving, and that's about it. The bond is quite excessive. It was reduced by vote, but it never got changed, so it's still a big bond. More than what you're going to need. But the Watts Landing Association is requesting is that the planning board will bring Mr. Tancredi in for Ashford Homes. Call him in to sit down and see what his, ask him, why are you not performing?
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Or there's another way of doing this too. You can ask him to come in and greet me, or you can send an official letter out, okay? Ask him to respond for a plan of action, okay? There's many methods here. I would ask, send a letter out first to him, that the board would like to sit down with him, okay, and see what is, come in and meet and talk and say why, okay? My professional experience with this is to do what I'm saying, because I've been there,
mm-hmm.
okay, with these types of situations. So it's always nice to bring them in and meet and greet.
Do we have a whole list of the outstanding items?
Yes, we have a copy of Lou's.
We have a report on Lou's report and building part of the separate entity all together. Right now, we want to get the road done. It's not going to get done before snowfall.
Yep.
Okay. I've been on his case since June. Yes, no, yes, no, yes, no, yes, no, and it's been going on. And it's not an uncommon practice.
Okay.
Sitting after was in the same boat with him on three projects, Concord as well. So, bring him in. Hey, hello.
So the next meeting is on December 1st?
First.
Is there anything else on the agenda of that meeting that...
You're not going to get him in that quick.
Why not?
We're going to try.
You could, we could,
could ask. But then you could have the excuse of the holidays, and then you're going into January.
Honestly say, guys, in December, he's going to be in the fine state of Florida. That's where he lives. This time of year.
And he has no one else that can address this issue. That's...
He does have a senior person that may come in.
Okay.
I've been told she's not involved with the road.
But there's other issues besides just the road, so why not ask her to come in for December 1st, and
well,
if they say no, we'll go the next step.
Let's ask the owner to come in.
Yeah, maybe
okay.
He'll still
and
be
see if he wants to come up here for December. Try it. That's my suggestion.
Okay.
Steve, you smile. Welcome to Building Trades.
I didn't say a word.
Should we mention in the letter that we do have a bond in place, just to remind him?
Remind him of the amount, too.
Trust me, he knows.
He knows,
where his money is.
Just get him in here to talk.
But what if he doesn't come in? I'm just throwing it out there.
Yeah.
What happens at that point?
The next step is securing the bond, which is going to take most of the winter. And legally, there's going to be some time on that.
But I think either he or his representative should come in, and they should be told that, because none of these builders want their bond pulled. It doesn't do a thing for them.
When's the bond expire?
I think it's a continuing...
To remodel the bond.
Continuing.
He will probably have his counsel come in and speak to you.
As long as we get somebody, would be good.
Is that project done?
All the homes are built.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Homes are built and sold. There's still a lot of...
There's a bunch of little stuff working.
Yeah. Landscaping issues.
It looks like a lot of catch basin issues.
Yeah.
The road stuff is catch basins and curving and burning. But I had a bond.
Yeah.
If I didn't have a bond, you know that's it.
It's to a point right now that it's potential to damage plows this winter.
I do plan on calling him tomorrow again on another matter, same on the other stuff, see if I can get an answer on the catch base that he said he was going to fix them before winter.
Well, get me a current address while you're talking to him where he can receive a certified letter.
Well, obviously, he has to be held accountable. I mean, if he says bond, I mean,
that's
town...
Like you said last week, that's what did Moose Hollow finally got
Do you have a sense, Kevin, of why he's not...
Well,
don't answer
the camera. Go
speaking,
I can't, and I won't do it on television. Okay.
Slammed.
I have an issue with it that goes back to 1982.
All right, maybe this should be off camera.
So he knows me; that he's very familiar how far I'll go. All
right, send him a letter for December 1st, and then if no one shows on that date, then we'll have the next step in terms of. Threat and pulling the bond, or what we decided to do.
You should have sent it to Pat, too, and the board.
Copy, yeah.
Yeah.
So
anything else for the board?
Nope.
How can we have motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Passes 5-0-1-0. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. The next meeting will be December 1st.
Maybe we'll call it next time.